साक्षात् परं ब्रह्म तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः। तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः। तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः। वेलकम एवरीवन, वी आर स्टार्टिंग ईशावास्य उपनिषद एंड आई हैव ऑलरेडी सेंट यू द बुकलेट्स। प्रोबेबली यू कैनॉट प्रिंट इट आउट योर सेल्फ, यू हैव टू गो टू द शॉप एंड गेट इट प्रिंटेड। इट्स लाइक अ बुकलेट, A5 बुकलेट और A4 बुकलेट। एंड बिकॉज यू चूज नॉट टू बी इन द वेनसडे ग्रुप, व्हाट्सएप ग्रुप, I'll send it to you separately. So you can, that's just verses and their meaning and for your ready reference. And in our Vedas, well, why we go into the Vedas, but let's talk about that. What are the Upanishads? Upanishads are the are the part of Vedas in which the Brahma Vidya or the Brahma Jnanam is given. And and for this, and this is only for those people for whom who are ignorant of the self. Now again, the Vedas, we have said it many times, explained it also, that the Vedas are basically the Karma Kand where rituals are mentioned. Majority of the Upanishads are 70-75% of rituals. Then comes the Upasana, when the rituals or the Karma Kand or the actions are done without any expectation of a result. Then a person purifies, and a purified person will, his mind becomes single pointed and he gets interested in the upasana side of it. And as he does upasana, upasana means upasan, sitting near. See? And this way he sits near whom? He sits near the Lord. He starts chanting the name. He starts chanting the suktas. With bhav, and as his mind becomes more and more, goes deep into itself, and as his mind gets purified, he comes across or he gets interested in the Upanishads. And they are all over the, they are not, people tell that there are about 12-14 Upanishads which are the major ones. It is the Western mind which has divided into major and minor Upanishads. It is not like that. Upanishads are Upanishads because all of them are guiding our, guiding the seeker to the Brahma Jnanam or the infinite reality. One moment, I forgot to charge it. The infinite reality. And there are hundreds of them, not one or two, or not 12 or 13. Hundreds of Upanishads are there. And in this way, then who is the person? See, this requires a very unique qualification to come to study the Upanishads? What is the unique qualification? We are so used to moving around in the world, experiencing everything objectively, seeing everything as separate, interacting with it, associating with it, owning it, having likes and dislikes. In other words, our whole disposition when we are interacting with the world is that of otherness. And what are these Upanishads indicating? Is it something which is other than you? No, they are talking about that principle for which knowing cannot be like I know you. You are sitting there and listening. Some of you I can see. Is it like this that I am going to come to know the Upanishads? अरे यार अभी क्या हो गया? Is it that I'm going to come to, are we going to come to know the Upanishads, the Brahma Jnanam, which is indicated by the Upanishads, the manner in which we come to experience, know the world? Is it in this manner? No. When it comes to Brahma Jnanam, knowing is being. And it has to be subjective. It cannot have the same rules of engagement that we have with the world when we are coming to the Upanishads. At the periphery, it seems we are studying the Upanishads, we are listening to the Upanishads, we are understanding is happening in the mind and intellect. But that is not enough. That is not enough. Because we are not talking about something which is other, which is separate. We are not talking about something which is separate from you. That Isha, which we are going to be expounding in this Upanishad, he is not separate to us. That Brahma Jnanam, that infinite reality, that truth is not separate from us. So, have we ever experienced ourselves separate from ourselves? Like we experience the world, have we ever experienced ourselves like that? Separate from ourselves? Is it possible? Someone will say, yeah, I had an out-of-body experience. I saw myself sleeping in the body, on the bed. There are people who have said that, experienced that. But that was the body. You are still there, outside the body. You are seeing the body. So one level is gone. Now what about the next? Then who is the one who is seeing the body? So when we come to this point, and this is not possible for this contemplation is not possible for every person. This person, he has lived his life in the world perfectly without getting disturbed, without he's living, performing his whatever he has to do in this world with dispassion. And that is why he was able to wean himself away from the rituals, then move on to the upasana, purify even more, and then eventually land up in the lap of the Upanishads or such students who have gone through this process. Then they went in search, what next? Nothing in this world is holding sway over me. I'm not interested in anything. I see the hollowness of this world. There is complete disinterestedness, indifference towards the world. But I'm still not knowing who I am. And such a student, when he goes to the teacher, to the Guru Maharaj, how does he go? Samit Pani Shrotriya Brahmanishtam. He goes with the, here it is, that topic is not there. But such seekers, when they are completely dried, dried of what? Dried of all emotions, all attachments, all desires. This is the moisture in our mind. This is the moisture. Usse sir dhua nikalta hai. Only smoke comes out. If the wife comes, smoke comes. Mother comes, smoke comes. Children come, smoke comes. Reaction. See? Then what is to be done? Anyway, what is to be done? He has worked it all out. It requires a special acumen to live in the midst of everything and yet not be disturbed by anything. It is very, very easy to leave your home and go to the Himalayas and start a new home there called ashram. Very easy. Then you've got your, then it's not a small home, it's a bigger home. There's a president, there's a vice president, there's a secretary, there are workers, there are properties. It becomes a big, big family. In the name of what? In the name of, we are educating the masses about the scriptures, the Sanatana Dharma. We are the beholders. We are not, this seeker is not interested in all this. Those who come to the Upanishads are not interested in improving the world. They want to realize. And what do they want to realize? They want to realize the truth. And where is this truth? It is not other than the self. What will happen if I come to know the self, come to know the Brahman or the truth? Then your vision will change. How will it change? Then wherever you see yourself. Wherever you see, there you are. Then there will be no place. No, but sir, then there will be no interest in life, there is no spice of life, everywhere I am, then what's the point of living? Ah, then you are not qualified for Upanishads. Then go somewhere else. Because this student has worked out everything. The hollowness of the possessions, hollowness of the relations, hollowness of the past, hollowness of the future. That there is no permanent happiness ever possible by engaging with this world. He has worked this out. And that is why when we were studying with Swamiji in the ashram, when the Upanishad started, all the windows were closed. Because those who are not qualified are not allowed to listen to the Upanishads. See? So that was more at a, then why are we teaching? Why are other teachers teaching if that is the case? Because we know those who are meant, those who are subjective only will understand this. Those who are objective in pursuit, those who are still lost in the wetness, in the mushiness of emotions, in the mushiness of attachment to the world, my child, my daughter, my son-in-law, my daughter-in-law, my food, my breakfast, my, they will seem to understand, but it will not click. Because it clicks only by grace, yes, absolutely, true. It can click to anyone anytime, no doubt. When we are putting efforts from our side, this is the minimum requirement when we come to the Upanishads. That with regards to this world, we have washed our hands. Nothing, no stone remains to be turned over. We have exhausted everything there. We have checked it out. We have observed. We have learned through other people's mistakes, through our own mistakes, through our experiences, that we have lived for so many years on this earth, in this body, trying to satisfy our desires. That's why we got married, that's why we have children, that's why we eat food every day, that's why we go to sleep every day, that's why we engage with the world every day. But till today, even after so many years of engaging with the world objectively, it has not given me lasting happiness. It has not given me the peace and tranquility which I am seeking. Whatever I feel, my partner will give me happiness, this food will give me happiness. If food gives me happiness, then why do I feel hungry after 4 or 5 hours again? Every mother thinks the child will give me happiness. Afterwards, he answers back then. She doesn't feel, oh, is this the reason I gave birth? Is this the type of child? I didn't want this type of child. Who answers back? See? 9 months I kept you in my womb. I spent sleepless nights to nourish you, only to see this day. One father came to someone and he said he used to give him left, right and center. Utte hi haath ud jata tha. One day that kid, when the father was about to hit, he caught his hand. Enough, dad. From that day, the relationship changed. See, yes, when we engage with scriptures, when we listen to satsangs, we can learn. But we can learn only if we are subjective in our approach. When we are not here to refute what the scriptures are saying, but instead our approach is, what the scriptures are saying, how can I implement it in my life? How can I see that what just now I have spoken for last 10-15 minutes, everything that I have said, have we observed that in our life? Or are we still beating the drum that no, I have to do my duties, relations and positions are important. If we don't satisfy our desires, what's the point of living life? If we keep insisting on that, then it's better you read Amar Chitra Katha and stay at home. Then Upanishad will frustrate you. It will not make any dent. Yes, you may appreciate that, oh, I went through the Upanishad, but nothing will happen unless and until we are subjective. And subjective means what? Subjective means going beyond the purport of the world. Words are limited. Words are finite. They are only to communicate. See? They are only there to communicate. If someone doesn't call you by your name, don't you continue to exist? Or do you need to hear your name all the time? Experience is that we continue to exist. Same way, this truth, this reality, it is beyond the world. It is beyond the scope of comprehension, understanding, or even of the mind. Such is this truth. And that I am. And therefore, here, this, with this, and with this introduction to the Upanishad, this Ishavasya Upanishad, where does it come? Okay, first, this Ishavasya Upanishad has 18 verses. Many masters say that these 18 verses are the 18 chapters of the Bhagavad Gita. So each chapter can be attributed to each verse of this Ishavasya Upanishad. And it comes in the 40th chapter of the Mantra Samhita of Shukla Yajurved. And most important thing is that when we are studying, normally our approach to anything is that we have to put efforts to gain something, isn't it? We have to do some karma. Like Bhagavad Gita is written from karma yoga point of view, bhakti yoga point of view, jnana yoga point of view. Upanishads are called Vedanta, Vedanta. Vedanta, Veda means Shabda, Shabda means words, Anta means end. Where the word ends, that is what Upanishads are. They talk about the truth without any ambiguity. Direct approach. And direct approach can be given, you can tell something or someone about something straight away when you know that he is ready. See? And what is the readiness? Everything that I have talked to you till now. So this Upanishad begins with the Shanti Mantra, and this Shanti Mantra is a very famous one which you all know. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnamevavashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Class is over. Because normally we end the class with this mantra, but here we are, the Upanishad is beginning itself with this mantra. Om Purnamada Purnamidam. See? So, what does it mean? What does it say? I don't have the copy which you have at the moment. Let me open it. Or anyway. So, it says, this is, that is whole, this is whole, from the whole becomes manifest. From the whole, when the whole is negated, what remains is again the whole. Therefore, Adi Shankaracharya says, I salute to that Ishvara who is the controller of the total world and is the total world. This is the invocation. What is that? The first word, Om. What is Om? Om is the natural sound of the universe, is the natural sound of the creation. It is the source of all alphabets, vowels and consonants. Is the source of the whole creation. Om has two ways. On one hand, it can give you everything in this creation because it is the creation. And on the other hand, the Om can deliver you to the doorsteps of the reality. Be it being the cause, it being the so essence. And in this way, so what is this? So that Isha, that reality, that truth, that Ishvara is indicated by the word Om. Most of the Upanishads in our script, in our Vedas, they begin with two words. Either it is Om or it is Atha. See? Om Namo Narayana, all mantras also, Om Namo Narayanaya, Om Namah Shivaya, Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya, Om Shri Ram Jai Ram Jai Jai Ram, Om Nidhana Pataye Namaha, Om Shivaya Namaha, etc. Everywhere Om. And yet other sex scriptures, they begin with Atha, Brahma Sutras, they begin with Atha. The Patanjali Yoga Sutras, they begin with Atha, Atha Yoga Anushasanam, Atha. Atha means now. Meaning that person has worked out whatever needed to be worked out and now he has come to this point. He's already sorted himself out of the, you know, that means you have gone through the nursery to year 12, now you are in university. But if you are still in nursery, if you are still in fifth standard and the university education is presented to you, will you understand? It will go over your head. So they have sorted themselves out. Same way here also, this we as seekers, we have sorted ourselves out again and again. And how do we sort out? By living alertly and vigilantly in our daily life, making sure that our life is not a desire-oriented life, and secondly, that nothing from this world is able to form an impression of our mind as a like or dislike. When these two parameters are taken care of, you become alert about, then very quickly the cards start falling. The mind starts dissolving. The ego starts dissolving, I should say. So do we have to do anything in the Upanishads? Another question many people ask. Do we have to do anything? After listening to what were we doing? After Vivek Chudamani. Now I have to practice. Lost the whole plot. After Upanishads also, nothing needs to be done. Then what do you do? Just like you have been enjoying the various scriptures by coming here or listening on the listening live and just enjoying it. Don't become too serious about it. Then what has to be done? The moment this question comes to our mind, what has to be done? We are so karma oriented that when it comes to Brahma Jnanam, there also we bring this karma into it. That what do I have to do? Because we are surrounded with this yoga everywhere. We are surrounded by pranayam. We are our life is just an karma, karma, karma everywhere. I have to do duty, I have to perform actions. If I don't perform action, then how will it happen? So when it comes to Upanishads also, what I have to do now? For this, we can only give you one or two examples, and that is what in the middle of the Kurukshetra war, what Bhagwan Shri Krishna told in the Bhagavad Gita. In that Bhagavad Gita, did Arjuna, while listening to it, did he do any karma? Did he do any japa sadhana?
Did he do patram pushpam phalam toyam? Did he offer anything at the feet of the Lord? Did he sit in meditation? Did he? No. Then what was the conclusion of the Bhagavad Gita? Bhagavan Krishna asked Arjuna, have you understood what I have said? And Arjuna says, yes, my delusion is gone. My confusion is gone. Now I have clarity. So, same thing when we look at Bhagavatam, Srimad Bhagavatam, there Parikshit Maharaj, he has got only 7 days to live. And he listens to the Bhagavat Mahapuran. And when he is listening to Bhagavat Mahapuran, so many stories are there, so many sadhanas are there, so many meditations are there. Did he do any one of them? No. And what happened at the end of the Bhagavatam? The Takshak Nag, the snake Takshak came. He bit the body of Parikshit. But Parikshit had already gone beyond. Beyond what? He did not go beyond being afraid of death. He went beyond both life and death. He transcended life and death. You can't go away and say, oh, then there will be rebirth after that. Parikshit, he transcended. Arjuna's delusion was removed as a result of listening to the discourse of Gita. So what should happen when we interact with the satsang of Upanishads or any satsang? Our wrong notions of life, our wrong conclusions of life with which we are living, which are detrimental to our peace, which are detrimental to God realization or self realization, which the scriptures say you are already that. Here the same Tattvamasi, you are already that, is being told by Purnamada, Purnamidam. We'll explain that. See? So these wrong notions have to be corrected. How will they be corrected? When we are available to the words of the scriptures. When we don't come with the baggage of what we have learned over the last so many years. We have seen many masters, everyone has come and gone. Sir, you will also come and go. Ho gaya kaam. I have finished Upanishad so many times. I have finished these scriptures so many times. Are Baba, scriptures were not to be finished. By study of scriptures, you were supposed to be finished. But we have got it wrong. That we have finished the scriptures. We get into I'm not saying it is wrong. Learn the Bhagavad Gita, learn the Upanishads. But it is not important. Important is only one thing. It must click. And it will click only when we are subjective in our approach. Subjective in approach means when we are going to that ultimate transcendental cause, transcendental principle, because of which everything is, in fact, there is not because of which everything is, that which is always. And what is that which is always? The self is that which is always. The Atma is that which is always. Sir, I am also. Which I? Jivatma is also always, no? Before birth, was the Jivatma there? After birth, will the Jivatma be there? No. Naturally, then the expressions of the Jivatma as the mother, wife, daughter, sister, brother, husband, all these, they will also not be there. The Jivatma himself is is expressing as the waker, dreamer, sleeper. They are also not permanently there. So come to this principle, and no Upanishad, no scripture is telling something out of their hat. They have whatever is told in the scriptures, as we saw in Vivek Chudamani, every verse we were taking you subjectively, that whatever is being told is happening in your life, but you have to just look at it. We are not ready to look at it because we are so obsessed with the world. We are so obsessed with our desires that we are not ready to look a thing as a thing. We look at a man, we call him husband. We look at a man, we call him son. We look at a woman, we call her mother or wife or sister. We look at gold, we call it ornament. We look at mud, we call it or taste mud or touch mud, but we call it a pot. So where's the fault? Where's the discrepancy? The discrepancy is, so once we come to know the truth, will we not touch the pot? Yes, you will still touch the pot. You will still look at the man in your life and call him husband only. But now you are doing it out of knowledge. Right now we are doing it out of attachment, infatuation, fear, ignorance, that as if this is my life. What is the life? The house with all the junk in it, all the memories in the USB, and the expectations of becoming a, what you call, mother-in-law or grandmother, etc., etc. This is not life. If we are looking forward to a life of tranquility and peace, if we want to realize the divine, you can't have two legs in two boats, one boat of spirituality and one boat of attachment with the world. You cannot. You will be split apart. It will be very painful. Because the boats will go in their own way. How long will you keep holding the boats together with your two legs? Not possible. Therefore, when we approach any just like when we begin here, Guru Brahma, Guru Vishnu, Guru Devo Maheshwara, Guru Sakshat Parabrahma Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha. We chant three Oms. Here also they are chanting the Om Purnamada Purnamidam. You all are listening here. You may have come from work. You may have just, maybe you are working from home nowadays, busy with your work, and you just left it and you come, or whatever you are doing. All that hurry-burry, all that engagement with the world, all that, I have to do this, I have to do that, I have to do that, all that is settled. Maybe when we were doing it here, you used to drive over here. Driving, you may drive, you may be the best driver, but it is stress. You have to, unknowingly you are collecting the stress of all the other traffic around. Stop, start, brake, change gears. Extreme alertness that I should not hit anybody or nobody should hit me. And then you come to the satsang And the moment you chant the three ohms and Guru Brahma, Guru Vishnu, everything just settles down. The mind calms with the chanting of the om. And you are doing this on your daily basis also. Whole day you are running, 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 running. And every evening, every night, you fall into the lap of sleep. Because you know, bliss is where there is silence. When there is too many options, stress increases. When less option, stress decreases. No option, bliss. So same way, every Upanishad, and here in Ishavasya Upanishad, the invocation, the mantra or the peace invocation is Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. And what does it mean? Om Purnam Adaha, Purnam Adaha. Second word, Purnam Idam. Purnat Purnam Udachyate. So Purnam Adaha, Purnam Adaha is that is whole. Purnam Idam, this is whole. This word is used to something which is close. That is used for something which is far away. Then Purnat, Purnat Purnam Udachyate. Then from that complete whole, from that completeness, Purnat Purnam Udachyate. What is that? The whole becomes manifest. Suppose I got 1 liter of water and out of it I pour some water into another glass. Here it is said, this is whole. And what is manifesting out of this is also whole. But that is not our experience. In life we see that whenever something comes out of something, the quantity reduces. Quantity reduces. If I got 1 liter and I pour out little bit, then less than a liter will be left in this bottle. So how can this 1 liter is full and what has come out is also full? Now this is not a contemplation which you can work out in your head. But you can appreciate the words, the what they are trying to indicate, that you can appreciate. We'll give you some examples as we go along. So Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate, that is whole. From that, when something is taken out, that this is also whole. So what remains behind is also whole, and what has come out is also complete. Is man coming out of man? Suppose man is the whole, out of him something comes out. What comes out? The husband comes out. Is he complete or is he incomplete? Is the son complete or is he incomplete? So man is complete, but the roles that are coming, the expressions that are coming out of him, They seem to be incomplete, isn't it? They seem to be incomplete. Because father is not the husband, is not the son, is not the employee, is not the employer. We have got strict demarcation lines around each one of them. But think another way. Out of the gold, the ornament comes. Out of the gold, ornament comes. Ornament is created, manifests. Is it not gold even after being an ornament? It continues to be ornament. Sorry, it continues to be gold. So before it was gold, and after that gold manifested as ornament, did the gold undergo any reduction? Did it? If you have, I don't know, is it one necklace or all what? Is it 100 grams or 1 kg? How much it is? I got no idea. So 1 kg necklace. मेरे ख्याल से बैल के गले में लगाने वाला होगा 1 किलो का. 1 kg necklace of gold, when it is converted into necklace, it still continues to be 1 kg gold. So before also it was gold. Out of that, what came out? Out of that gold, what manifested? Necklace manifested. And it is told, it is also complete. How it is complete? Because it is not other than gold. Take another example, which is very popular. You have heard the water and the waves. The water is complete, the whole waters, out of which the wave is created, manifests. Yes, wave is temporary. The ornament is also temporary. The wave is also temporary. The husband is also temporary. That wave, but what is the material that has gone into it? Is it made up of some foreign material or it is made up of water only? So what was the source? Water. What, so we are talking about cause and effect. So what was the cause? The water, total waters. They are complete. Out of that, what was manifesting? The wave. What is wave? Nothing but water. But where is our attention? On the form. Where is our attention? Our attention is not on the gold. Our attention is on the ornament. Our attention is not on the man or the woman that we are. Our attention is on the role that we are playing. And the one who's frustrated is the role, not the man or the woman. The mother is frustrated, the husband is frustrated, the wife is frustrated, the son is frustrated, not the man or woman. So, being aware of this. So, what is this verse telling you? Hey man, stop getting frustrated, stop getting agitated, stop becoming restless. Everything is complete. Now you start thinking in such a way that everything is auspicious, everything is complete, everything is om, everything is that divine. Out of divine, if everything is divine and that divine has created the creation, how can the creation be undivine? And we take that creation and get stuck with it and try to seek divinity in that creation. Very difficult. You have to seek the divinity within yourself as yourself. Two ways you can approach this divinity. One is that everything is, what do you call? ब्रह्म सत्यम जगत मिथ्या, वन इज दिस वे, दैट ट्रुथ अलोन इज, एवरीथिंग एल्स इज इल्यूजन. दिस इज वन वे ऑफ अप्रोच. एंड द अदर अप्रोच इज सर्वम खलविदम ब्रह्म, एवरीथिंग इज ब्रह्मन. फर्स्ट अप्रोच इज द व्यतिरेक साधना, सेकेंड अप्रोच इज द अन्वय साधना. फर्स्ट अप्रोच, आई एम नॉट द वर्ल्ड, आई एम नॉट द बॉडी, आई एम नॉट द माइंड, आई एम नॉट द इंटेलेक्ट, आई एम द सो ऑन एंड आई एम द आत्मा. दिस इज आई एम नॉट, आई एम नॉट, आई एम नॉट. आफ्टर कमिंग टू आत्मा, इफ दिस आत्मा इज नॉट रिवीलिंग एज सर्वम खलविदम ब्रह्मा, देन वी हैव गॉन रॉन्ग इन अवर अप्रोच समवेयर. देन मैक्सिमम दैट विल हैपन टू दिस सीकर विल बी going to nirvikalpa samadhi, coming out of nirvikalpa samadhi, again going to nirvikalpa samadhi, coming out of nirvikalpa samadhi. Sitting in meditation for 4, 4, 5, 5 hours is not the goal. The goal is that once and for all this seeking must end. And this seeking is going on only because we have accepted ourselves to be an individual. We have accepted ourselves to be the ornament. Actually, we are the gold. Because our attention is on our name and form. And we are attached to that name and form. Accept what is the essence of ours. What is that without which this I will not be me, or this body will cease to exist? What is that? Be that. So these are the two approaches. So here in Purnamada, we are not talking about Brahma Satyam Jagan Mithya. We are talking about Sarvam Khalvidam Brahma. Cause is also complete, effect is also complete. See? But you need the eye to look at it. You need to have the eye. If you are just lost in the form, if you are just lost in the attachments, if you are not able to be the scientist that is required to discriminate, and then otherwise we will be lost. Oh, how is it possible? How is it not? If you look at the form, then you are the ornament. But ornament cannot be without the gold. The material that has gone into making the ornament is nothing but the gold. The material that has gone into making this seeker is nothing but the divine. Because creation cannot be separate from the divine. It is part and parcel. Purnamada Purnamidam. Out of that complete divinity, this creation came out, and that creation is also complete. See? So what is this ornament? If everything is, before also it was gold, after the creation of the ornament was also, it was still gold, then what is ornament then? Ornament is a superimposition on the gold. Understand? The form is the superimposition on the gold. The form of the wave is the superimposition on the superimposition for that Amma there, imagination. It's a superimposition on the waters. Now apply it to yourself. This form is the superimposition on the spirit, on the consciousness that I am. What is the belief with which we live? That the self is in the body somewhere. that the mind is here, their self is somewhere inside. But the truth is a completely opposite. In the self, everything is, the body is. In the self, the prana and the mana, the annamaya kosh, the pranamaya kosh is inclusive of the annamaya kosh. The manomaya kosh is inclusive of the pranamaya and the annamaya. The vijnanamaya kosh is inclusive. Vijnanamaya kosh becomes the cause. And it is inclusive of, it alone is expressing as the manomaya, pranamaya and annamaya. And who knows all this? The Atma. All these are nothing but, can these four, five koshas be separate from the Atma? Is it possible? Is it possible? No. Because the Atma is pervading all the four koshas, five koshas, all the time. But we are obsessed with the form. We are obsessed with the idea. We have made ourselves believe that I am only this body, that I am only this, without breath I cannot live. Without thinking I am going cuckoo. That I am an intellectual or I am stupid. That has got nothing to do with the Atma. That is all equipment level. But because we are thinking only about the specific expression, wave is a specific expression of water, ornament is a specific expression of the gold, pot is a specific expression of the mud, body is the specific expression of the consciousness, an ice cube is a specific expression of the infinite waters. Under certain conditions, it has crystallized. Under certain conditions. But because it has crystallized, doesn't mean that it has a separate existence from H2O. Just because this body has crystallized in existence and has got a form, has got a shape, has got a name, doesn't mean that it is separate from the infinite reality. It seems that way, no? Water and ice cube, separate. It seems that way. Such a huge universe, me teeny meeny. We have to stop thinking of ourselves as the effect. We are the source. We are the source. We are the spirit. We are the being. So here, the idea that, see, when we experience the world, how do we experience the world? That I am the experiencer. This is the experienced world. Right? And there is an experience going on between the experiencer and the experienced. But these three, the experiencer, the experienced, they are none other than the reality. At individual level, it is very difficult to understand that. Because we are so obsessed with our form. Look at it from space's point of view. Space is complete, it's infinite. Out of that, you created this house space. And you call it number 11 Wolseley Avenue. Has it become limited? When we call it, this is my house space, where is my attention? The emphasis was not on the space. The emphasis was on the house. The emphasis was on the conditionings. Space is neither inside nor outside. But because you built a wall around it and you call it your space, good luck to you. You created the inside space and the outside space. In space, there is no inside and outside. You created in space the various direction. From space, direct space point of view, there are no directions. See? Similarly, this Atma is complete. This reality is complete. There are no divisions possible in reality because reality is one without a second. Ekameva Dvitiya. One without a second. Then what about the creation? It seems I am stuck in the creation and I am searching the reality. But you are saying everything is reality. Ekameva Dvitiya. Then where is the creation? It's inherent. Don't look at creation and reality as two separate. Reality is pervading in and through the entire creation. We don't have the eye to look at it at this moment. But hopefully, after the as we go through the Upanishad, the clarity comes and we abide in that reality. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnamevavashishyate. The second line says that Purnasya, from the whole, Purnam Adaya, from the whole is negated. When you remove the whole from the whole, from the complete, you are removing some of the complete or the complete. What remains is only the completeness. So from completeness, some completeness is removed out. So what remains behind is complete and what you have taken out is also complete. This is not a correct equation. Something is wrong here. Something is wrong here. But that is the truth, that is the reality. All creation from this Om Purnamada Purnamidam, if the scriptures are declaring this statement that reality is complete, and from reality, anything that is created, the reality does not undergo reduction. And that which has come out of the reality, or has been created out of the reality, or has manifested out of the reality, whatever has manifested is equal to reality. It cannot be separate or less. It cannot be less than reality, it cannot be more than reality, it is still reality. See? Now you start looking for examples. I have already given you quite a few, but you start looking around in your daily life. To prove this statement true, not to refute this statement. We are not a critic. We find fault with everything. Because, so we have to find how this statement of truth, or this invocation which is being told, how this is happening in and through me, in my experience, in my life, where all I can observe it. Apply, develop that vision. And once we develop this vision that everything is complete, then there will be no fighting, there will be no reaction, there will be no... You don't have to do anything in order to please anyone. Because everything is complete, everything is perfect as it is. But what we want, if we see a young girl, hey, why don't you get married? If she's married, why don't you have a child? If you have a child, why don't you have a second one? We are not happy the way they are. You see, chavi deke aa jate hum. Because we do not accept everyone as they are. Just like all the variety, just as all the variety of the dream becomes zero on waking up, just like all the limbs of the ghost or all the reactions of being bit by that imaginary snake become neutralized the moment you come to know, Re Baba, it was a rope. The moment you come to know that it was a post, it was not a ghost. But those illusions, those imaginations of snake and ghost, they could not happen without the rope and the post. The imagination of the ornament could not happen without the presence of the gold. The imagination of the role called husband or wife cannot happen without the presence of the man or the woman. Similarly, the presence of the panchakoshas cannot be possible without the cause, without the material. What is the material cause? What is the material cause of these panchakoshas? You will say space, air, fire, water, earth. What is the material cause of the space, air, fire, water, earth? What is the cause of the space, air, fire, water, earth? You will say it is the tamas. What is the cause of tamas? The avyakta. Where did the avyakta, can avyakta, the unmanifest, exist by itself? No, it is the potential of the Ishvara. There you go. So is the potential separate from is the potentiality separate from the potential? Is the Shakti separate from the Shaktiman? Is Radha separate from Krishna? Is Shakti separate from Shiva? But Shiva doesn't get disturbed by the coming and going of the Shakti. The manifestation and the unmanifestation of the Shakti, Shiva remains ever the same. See? Recognize this. This is not just a story. Recognize this about yourself. What is that permanent principle? What is that unchanging principle which remains unaffected, unchanged, undisturbed, ever alert, ever aware, in spite of the manifestation of the waking, unmanifestation of the waking, appearance of the dream, disappearance of the dream? What is that? Who continues to be? Then where is the mistake we are making? We have taken ourselves to be the Jagrat Purush. We have taken ourselves to be the Sapna Purush. We have taken ourselves to be the Sushupti. There is no Purush in Sushupti. In Sushupti, you become one with reality. So in this manner, the just as the snake can never appear without the rope being there. If there is no rope, there can be no snake. If there is no gold, there can be no ornament. And the rope doesn't give you trouble. The imaginary snake gives you trouble. Similarly, the spirit doesn't give you trouble, which is your true nature. Then what is that? Your imagined nature. That I am the body, that I am this, and I am that. The Gaunatma and the Mithyatma, they give us the trouble. Because they are imaginations on the original, Mukhyatma. When we are talking about Gaunatma, the mother, father, daughter, sister, etc. Mithyatma, I am Annamaya Kosh, Pranamaya Kosh, Manomaya Kosh, Vigyanamaya Kosh. Mukhyatma, I am the reality. Aham Brahmasmi. Without a thought. So this phenomena will continue. But phenomena cannot continue without the substratum. Waves cannot come without the substratum of water. Similarly, apply it on yourself. This phenomena, the body is continuously changing, the senses are continuously changing, the breath is continuously changing, the mind is continuously changing, the thoughts are continuously changing, our concepts are continuously changing. The waking, dream and sleep, they are continuously coming and going. They are also changing. That which is changing is phenomena. What is phenomena? Appearance. There are different words for it. Appearance, illusion, that which exists in its own absence is phenomena. Seems to be there but is not there actually. Husband seems to be there but is not there, because when you go and touch the husband, you touch the man, you don't touch the husband. Think. We have to reinitiate. Why do we come to satsang? We don't come to satsang to learn. We don't come to satsang to learn. We are not coming to Upanishads and approaching the Upanishads to learn. Then what are we coming to Upanishads for? To unlearn. Everything that we have thought we have to undo. That's why we are coming and approaching the Upanishads. One master was there. He said, I did the same thing but in a different way. When I take, still now, since COVID, the Sanskrit classes are stopped. My rule was, classes are free. All Sanskrit, all classes are free. Sanskrit class is also free. But if you miss a class, you have to pay me $10. If you attend the class, it's free. But one musician, he had a different rule there. If you know how to play tabla, it is $50 per class. If you don't know how to play tabla, you don't know what tabla is, then only $10. Then someone went, why? You should appreciate that I know already so much, then why should I, if I know something already, why should I pay $50? And for someone who doesn't know anything, you are giving him only for $10 the class. The teacher said, if a person doesn't know anything, it is very easy to program that. When the disk is empty, you can reprogram it. But if the disk is full, you have to first empty it. So my $50, actually it is $10 for the class. $40 is for emptying your disk. The wrong things that you have learned, the ahankar, the ego that you have, that you have, you already know playing tabla. So someone who says or comes with this disposition that I know, I have studied this Upanishad, I know everything, then it's very difficult to change. We have to come empty. We have to, this is the, if we keep this approach of Purnamada Purnamidam throughout our life, what a wonderful life it will be. That all the time there is only perfection expressing. Not even expressing, expression is. Perfection is the substratum, the wholeness is the substratum, the completeness is the substratum. In spite of the world, in spite of the roles that come manifest out of us, in spite of the demands of the body, breath, mind, intellect, perfection ever is. Completeness ever is. That is the spirit. Spirit is not one per person, Baba. Consciousness is not one per person. Water is not one per wave. Gold is not one per ornament. Gold is infinite. Water is infinite. So also this spirit is infinite. But our attention is space, this space, just like we imagine the countries on the earth. But the earth is complete. We have broken imaginary lines we have created. Calling this is Australia, this is America, this is India, this is China. Imaginary lines. We have created imaginary lines. This is the body, this is the breath, this is the mind, this is the intellect, this is the husband, this is the wife, this is this, this is that. We have created directions. This is the north, this is the south, this is the east, this is the west. In space there are no directions. So understand. Don't get lost in the phenomena. So when we approach this, Upanishad hasn't started yet. We are only in the invocation mantra. This is the preparation. This is the mindset that with which we are going to enter the Upanishad. That everything is complete. Everything is whole. There's nothing lacking. And that is the truth. And that I am. Don't forget that. Continuing. So when we are meditating, when we are contemplating, when we are studying the Upanishad, when we are told, control your senses, control your mind, contemplate on the self, are we creating the self? Are we creating the Atma? No. Atma is already there. It was always present. You cannot create Atma. You can invoke the wife in you. You can invoke the daughter in you. You can invoke the mother in you. You cannot invoke Atma in you. You cannot invoke Atma. Because Atma is the material. Atma is the substratum. Atma is not an object which can come and go. It's not an experience which will come and go away. Wife comes and goes away. Mother comes and goes away. Daughter comes and goes away. Ornament comes and goes away. Wave comes and goes away. House comes and goes away. Countries, contours, they can change. Time can change, but not Atma. Atma never changes. Oh, I know myself. But you know, today it's not clicking, man. It cannot be. Then it was an imagination of your intellect. Once it clicks, it's over. In fact, it is always. We have to take that position. So here, the Upanishads, the various, any Upanishad for that matter, their intention is not to create Atma, but to or we are not creating Atma, which was absent before, and now by your sadhana, by exposing your mind to the Upanishad and following the dictates of the Upanishads or the contemplations in the Upanishad, now we'll create the Atma. No, it is not like that. Don't go in that direction of thinking. It is ever complete. It is ever there. There is nothing else other than this self. This we have to accept about ourselves. Then the fear of death will go away. If we follow this verse, Om Purnamada Purnamidam, then your desires will wane away, because everything is complete. And if it is taken as subjectively, then there is no desire for anything. What will you pursue? Then every moment of your existence will be bliss. Full of joy, full of inspiration. See? So the Upanishads do not create the Atma, they only reveal. And how do they reveal? By using contradictory language, because that's the only mode of communication here. So when they are using the words this, that is whole, and when from that this is removed, what remains behind is whole, what comes out is also whole. These are words, isn't it? These are words. Infinite is a word. But have we experienced infinity? Wholeness is a word. Have we experienced wholeness? Space is a word. Have we experienced space? Mind is a word. Have we ever seen the mind? Similarly, we have given a name because language is required. Language is the means of communication. But that truth which is beyond the language, the language is utilized in such a manner, if the student, if the seeker is subjective, that which we are talking about, which that which the words are indicating, is not an object of contemplation. That object, which seems to be a word in your mouth or a thought in your mind, the self, is you. It is not an object to be achieved or attained or created. It is your essential nature. You are that. So in this manner, Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. Three times the word Shanti is used. What are these three Shantis? These Shantis are, one is the Adi Daivik Shanti. Two, Shanti means peace, invocation of peace. Peace for what? We are persecuted by troubles, challenges, difficulties from unseen forces. Unseen forces, earthquakes, fire, you know, the like in California, the fires are going on, floods are going on in India or in New South Wales. Unseen accidents also, there you nobody makes an accident happen, it happens. Unseen forces, they are called Adi Daivik Tapa. Tapa means afflictions, disease. You don't plan to have a disease, it happens. Unseen, you have someone is practicing wonderful hygiene and health and food and everything, still they get sometimes we see people catching, and someone who's not following anything and doesn't catch anything. Adi Daivik Tap. Then second is Adi Bhautik Tap. Afflictions from those things which we can control. From those things which we can control. If we know that if we get into a company of bad people, instead of influencing them, we will get influenced, then don't go. Don't go to the jails to improve the criminals. Let those who are qualified do that. Otherwise, you will become a problem to the society. See? This is Adi Bhautikta. That those things which are within your purview of control, which you can do something about. If I am not supposed to overeat every day, if I am not supposed to take too much sugar, then you stop taking sugar. It is in your control. But we continue and then invite the troubles. And you can keep multiplying the examples. And the last one is, so first was Adhi Daivik Tap, from afflictions from unseen forces, troubles from unseen forces. Then Adhi Bhautik Tap, that afflictions from those things which are within your control. And the third is Adhyatmik, the afflictions or troubles from within. And they are more than the outside. Our mind is self-sufficient to destroy itself if it loses the plot. If it loses the plot. Adi Daivik Tap. Adhyatmik Tap. So discipline your mind. Give it a dose of positive thoughts. Make it continuously. Keep it with the Lord's name. That's the best way. And keep it with the Lord's name with bhav, with feeling. not just mechanically going on. So mouth is chanting the name and your mind is still doing what it wants to do. That will not work. Another way of looking at it is that the first shanti is that let my body be quiet. Let my body be quiet. How many bodies we have? Three bodies. Gross body, subtle body, causal body, right? One way of looking at it. So let the gross body be quiet. Continuously, kuch na kuch karte rehna hai. We have to keep doing, 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 doing. Workaholic. He can't sit quiet. Kuch nahi toh jhadu marte ro bar bar. Must learn to sit with yourself doing nothing for a change. And yet not be lazy. Yet not be lazy. If it is required to be done, do it. But this itch must not be there inside of us of continuous engagement with the world. I have to call this person, I have to call that person, I have to buy this present, I have to do this, I have to do that, I have to do this, I have to do that. Kab tak? You have done all this for so many years, 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, I don't know if someone is 70. 80, 80 is there, I know one. Huh? How long? Continuous engagement in the world. Hey, already 9 o'clock. Huh, so let's quickly conclude. Then the subtle body, second shanti is for the subtle body. What is that subtle body? Let me not project at the level of subtle body. Let me not imagine that I am not realized, that I am realized, that I can't do it, that it is very difficult, that it is very easy, that I am a master of this or I am a slave of this. No. Don't project anything. That I am a husband, that I am a mother, I am this. No, I am the Atma, I am the Self, I am complete. Purnamada Purnamidam. Don't project. Let the projection at the subtle body level, let that pacify. So agitations at the physical body level, let them pacify. Let the projections at the subtle body level, which is mind and intellect level, let them pacify. Let them quieten down. Let them dissolve. And third, the causal body. What is causal body? Causal body is already silence. Deep sleep is silence. So what do? Silence the silence. That means you go beyond the silence. And in this way, when we become awake to the silence, what happens to us? We become enslaved by the silence. We become addicted to the silence. When we become addicted to the silence, if too much sound is there, we cannot handle it. That is why we go to sleep every night. But if we can bring about a disposition where we become awake to the silence, then we are truly awake. Then when that happens, neither we are disturbed by the silence nor we are disturbed by the noise. Understand, silence is not the goal, because silence is opposite of noise. We want to go beyond the opposites. So at the causal level, that whatever we are listening in our satsangs, let it not become an objective understanding. Let it happen, let it be the subjective experience even while listening is going on. When that happens, then you have woken up to the silence. And in this way, we will conclude here for today. We'll continue with a few points of the Purnamada Purnamidam, and then jump into the first verse. Ishavasya medagam sarvam yat kinchit jagatyam jagat तेन त्यक्तेन भुंजिथाः मा गृधकस्य सिद्ध्वनम्. वी लुक एट दैट वर्स इन द नेक्स्ट क्लास. ओम पूर्णमदा पूर्णमिदं पूर्णात् पूर्णमुदच्यते पूर्णस्य पूर्णमादाय पूर्णमेवावशिष्यते. ओम शांति 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 ही. हरि ओम श्री गुरुभ्यो नमः. हरि ओम. Just sit in silence for some time. हरि ओम.
हरि ओम स्वामी जी.
हरि ओम. सी यू.